Townhall and your cash bail as they address the issue of criminal justice reform here in the city of Philadelphia. As mentioned, I'm Councilman Johnson, representing the 2nd Councilmatic District.
Ms. McClinton, the bail is low enough. Well, see, actually, Judge, the bail's not low enough because nobody wants to spend the night on State Road.
That's right.
Hello, somebody.
That's right.
Nobody wants to go up there checking in like it's the Radisson, the Hilton, Riviera. So the bail's not low enough. So this issue is important. It's so important that I've introduced legislation in Harrisburg statewide so that we can deal with this. It's one of the things that I've been fighting for in the entire arena of criminal justice as it relates to things like my neighbor, Ms. Christine Riddick's son, getting a second chance, to also making sure that people who are violently committing the crimes we don't like to watch on the news are punished adequately. That is criminal justice reform. It's ensuring that the public is safe, and it's also ensuring that those who need a second, third, fourth chance, if you need one of them, we're doing expungements.
The ACLU of Pennsylvania, and it is really an honor for me to be here today with all of the stakeholders who have been working so hard and with all of you who are so committed and passionate about this issue. The ACLU's vision is that money should not determine one's freedom from incarceration, that families should remain together and not be torn apart or indebted simply because of an arrest, that people are assumed innocent until proven guilty, that conditions of release are limited, and pretrial detention is exceedingly rare, that the criminal justice system should respect the dignity and equality of all people. And our mission to accomplish this vision is to implement systems and foster cultural change that ensure pretrial detention is almost never used, that eliminates wealth-based detention, and combats racial disparities. Philadelphia's current system of cash bail violates this vision and violates multiple constitutional protections. It upends the presumption of innocence, it violates the prohibition on excessive bail, it violates equal protection clause. We're seeing some amazing activists coming through right now, so please welcome them. And it violates due process protections. So setting monetary bail higher than someone should afford to keep them incarcerated until their trial should not be done. Our own Pennsylvania rules guard against that, and as well as the Constitution. We know that people are incarcerated. They're incarcerated by the hundreds of on state roads simply because they can't afford to pay bail. And we applaud all of these efforts to eliminate that. We would also like to urge all of these stakeholders to remember that pretrial liberty is a fundamental right, and that cash bail should never be used as a de facto way to detain people. Before the state can incarcerate someone pretrial, due process requires a full-blown adversarial hearing where the accused has the right to present evidence, to cross-examine the witnesses against them, and to be represented by counsel. So, and only after that full-blown hearing, only then should someone be incarcerated pretrial in public safety.
So, Mr. Kraft, part of your platform was the in-cash bail, and you recently announced your plan to reduce the court's reliance on cash bail. Can you walk us through the alternative cash bail system? And the second question is, I understand you use crime statistics to determine which charges should no longer require cash bail. Are there substantive reasons for choosing these charges? For instance, by listing possession of marijuana, how does that free up resources to curtail illegal drug distribution? But also, an individual reached out to me on Facebook and said, what's going to be the incentive for individuals to come to court if we aren't using a cash bail system? So that was directly asked of the individual to start us off by kind of shaping the framework of your new legislation.
Is that system more like the one in the District of Columbia, where they never use cash as an aspect of bail? That does not mean that everyone gets to go home. Charged with a mass shooting, you don't go home. What they do is they use other means. They never make it dependent upon money. In fact, it's against the law of the District of Columbia to have money be an aspect of your bail. So approximately 12% of people end up detained, either because the case is so dangerous or their chance of showing up is so low, or both. And about 88% go home without having to pay any money. They may or may not have conditions that they have to comply with in order to go to court. Sometimes mental health issues would require checking with a mental health center, things of that sort. But the 88% who are released have very low recidivism, and they go to court and almost never have violent recidivism. That's just a fact, and it's a fact after 30 years. We can all sit here and act like we're being logical when we speculate about what happens, but we don't have to speculate. It works. It's actually that simple. And that's why they're doing it in New Jersey and in Kentucky, and that's part of the reason we're trying to go that direction here. Not as simple here, because we're not going to get the state legislature to make cash bail illegal. It's the state legislature that loves Donald Trump, and they also love
watch
the
watch it, watch it.
Don't mess us all together.
You know, I was being geographically inaccurate. I was speaking of the part of the state that has the Trump lawn sign, so that's the most definite.
It's not Southwest Philly.
So that's the goal. Now, what do we do? So we had a really good policy team, including people like Mike Lee over there and a bunch of other people, criminologists as well, look at the category of people in Philadelphia who have been charged between $0 and $10,000 on a regular basis. And then we look for what offenses associated with those bails were nonviolent, do not involve sexual assault. And that is how we came up with a list that includes some things that really should not be controversial, like marijuana possession, which we're no longer going to charge anyway, but things that are in fact a little bit more controversial, like possession with intent to deliver relatively minor amounts of drugs, or like burglary where it is an unoccupied commercial structure. It is a whole list of offenses. The way the system works is simply that we presume that you don't want cash. There may be an exceptional situation, and that's why it's a presumption. It's not a mandatory, but that is the presumption. Now, that has been in effect in Philadelphia, meaning that the assistant district attorneys who are in the room where the bail is set when somebody is arrested are making these recommendations to judges who, frankly, are not used to this, and this has been going on now for about 10 days. Or so. It is only a phase one. We're hoping to have a phase two in which we include more offenses, but we need to show some success. We need to show that people remain safe. We need to show that defendants show up for court, which we are confident will happen. And then there will be a phase two down the road after we've seen in detail what's going on.
And I'm curious to know, what tools will the Defender Association need to be able to implement the new policy? It's only been 10 days, so it's at the obvious very beginning of a minimal cash bail being used in the city. But what tools will your office need? I can remember being in court some days with judges being upset because people weren't showing up to court
or they were sister's keeper. I mean, there's a lot of people here that understand reentry and understand what we need to do to help people move along and when they come out of jail and they're in the communities. But what about pre-entry? Meaning people don't even have to go to jail if they understand how to navigate the system and hold true to their responsibilities. One of the things I always say to people is that we got people putting their neck on the lines, making these new policies and saying that this is a better way to practice criminal justice, because we know that to be true. But then we'll have the naysayers saying, well, what about the guy that got rearrested? What about the guy that didn't show up? Well, what if that is reduced so much that you can't even bring that up as an issue? You know, what if majority of the people actually show up to court and do what they're supposed to do? What if majority of the people stay arrest-free during that time? Wouldn't that be a wonderful thing? Well, what do we need to do that? When people get out pre-trial, we need to find, and we are doing this now at the Public Defender's Office, we are finding community solutions to keep them progressing. So we're working and teaming up with those centers. We worked with Project Dad, and he's accepting people pre-trial. And we're telling him, hey, would you remind people of their obligations to show up for court? Make sure that you have that as part of your programming. What are your obligations today? Make sure that you do things to keep people on a progressive track. Yeah, we're not saying everyone's going to be perfect, but what they want to do is start to work towards an understanding of what they need. And then we're hoping down the road that when people start doing things on their own, connecting the structures in their communities, that we can come to a reasonable DA and say, hey, this guy has been making this progress and doing this. Can we status this for a little while and figure out whether we need to keep him in our criminal justice system and label him a convict? Because the stakes are too high. We're dealing off felonies and convictions like this candy and not even understanding the So I really think that working with Larry will bring about a better understanding of who should be in our system and who does not need to be in our system. Thank you.
For Julie Wertheim, she's the chief of staff for the Office of Criminal Justice. Julie, we know that the city of Philadelphia received an infusion of $3.5 million from MacArthur Foundation to reduce the prison population. Currently has done so by 22%. How has this funding been leveraged to reduce the pretrial population?
The allocation is 34%. That's not a finish line for us by any means, though. I think the work's going to continue for as long as it needs to safely bring down the jail population while reforming the system. A lot of the funding in the grant that was awarded almost 2 years ago went into pretrial initiatives. And I actually would like to defer to Mr. Bouchard to speak about them because he oversees the vast majority of them.
Yes, like Julie said, there are several initiatives in the MacArthur grant focuses on the pretrial population, and I can touch on a few of those now. One of the earliest initiatives that launched in July of 2016 is our early bail review hearings. So those hearings are for a specific set of nonviolent charges that the District Attorney's Office and the Defenders Association agreed to, with cash bails of $50,000 or less. We'll receive a hearing within 5 days to make a determination to release them. I can say that since that program started in July of 2016, 82% of people who received those hearings are being released either on their own recognizance, on SOB, sign-on bond, or on pretrial supervision. Also, of those defendants on the program, 89% are showing up for the next court date. The court's overall appearance rate is over 90%. So the court does issue phone call reminders, text reminders, and email reminders to everybody. So even if you have no type of supervision in Philadelphia, if you have a court date, you're going to get a reminder of some sort. The program has saved, through the life of the program, it's saved over 113,000 bed days up on State Road. So it's been very successful. Chicago's reached out to us, New York's reached out to us to try to replicate a program in their jurisdictions. The next program is the Bail Advocates Program, which is overseen by the Defenders Association. And the goal there is to allow for a more robust advocacy for defendants at arraignment. So it's currently in a pilot phase at the police headquarters. And so far, the Defenders Association has interviewed over 1,300 defendants. And the actual numbers, quantitative feedback, we don't have yet. We are currently working with the Defenders Association to get feedback on how that program is running. But the initial feedback is that it's really something positive to get that advocacy as early as possible, even pre-arraignment for defendants. And third is the transition of our electronic monitoring hardware and software. So we were functioning off of hardware and software 2 months ago that was from the mid-90s. So there were people who were able to be released on electronic monitoring who could not be because they couldn't get a phone line into their home. And it had to be a specific phone line. In some parts of the city, Verizon doesn't even run anymore. So we were up against that, and with the funding of the MacArthur Foundation, we were able to update all that. We now use cellular units, so you don't have to have a phone line, you don't have to pay to have a phone line in your house to be released from prison on electronic monitoring.
Nice.
The good news with electronic monitoring, there's always a concern for over-monitoring of defendants, and as the prison population has shrunk by 24% over 2 years, we have also reduced the number of people on electronic monitoring, so
nice.
It's important. We are, as has been stated, we're doing it safely, making sure we're addressing the appropriate population. Those are the main pretrial initiatives we fall under the grant.
How are bail commissioners and judges educated on the available pretrial arrangements and which are best suited to which charges?
Judges or magistrates or decisions when it comes to bail. What I can say is that when a defendant is placed on any type of pretrial supervision, we do the best we can with the resources we have to get any assistance that is needed, whether it be housing, whether it be medical, whether it be drug and alcohol, anger management, to direct them to the appropriate social services in the community. I can refer back to Mr. Krasner discussing Washington, D.C.'s pretrial program. It's absolutely phenomenal, and it's a model that I hope to follow. They have in-house resources for pretty much any social service you could imagine. So we don't have those in-house right now, but we work with the community in sending defendants to where their needs are best met.
So the Philadelphia Community Bail Fund, we actually started on Mother's Day last year. It's part of a national movement that was inspired by some settlers on the ground who wanted to bail out Black mothers and caregivers in time for Mother's Day so they could be home with their family. And so cities all over the country participated. Philadelphia, we came in with a week to go, and we're just like, all right, I don't know how to do this, but we're gonna do this. And we managed to raise nearly $60,000 in 1 week from tons of individual donations. And so we were able, again, we probably could have done a lot more people if we had more infrastructure in place, but we were just, you know, going by the seat of our pants doing what we could. And so we were able to get 13 women out in time for Mother's Day. And so because of the success of that and what we learned on sort of being thrown in the fire, we decided to try to open up this bail fund and to make the community, Philadelphia Community Bail Fund, so that we can bail out all people. And so that has been going strong since November 2017. And our goal is we want to bring our people home. And our ultimate goal, of course, is decarceration, and we want to end money bail. And in the meantime, we're trying to raise money and do all we can to bring as many people home as possible. Some of the people that we bailed out on Mother's Day alone, one person, Joanne, she was in prison for 5 days. But another woman that we bailed out, she was there for 14 months and had never seen or talked to her attorney. She couldn't even understand her charges. And so for us, we're really convicted having been in the process and speaking with people who are waiting and hoping to get out of jail, that this is a really urgent matter. This is not just a matter of statistics or percentages or yeah, we got it down to 24%. It's no, we need to do as much as we can to get our people out. So the Philadelphia Community Bail Fund, we actually started on Mother's Day last year. It's part of a national movement that was inspired by some settlers on the ground who wanted to bail out Black mothers and caregivers in time for Mother's Day so they could be home with their family. And so cities all over the country participated. Philadelphia, we came in with a week to go, and we're just like, all right, I don't know how to do this, but we're gonna do this. And we managed to raise nearly $60,000 in 1 week from tons of individual donations. And so we were able, again, we probably could have done a lot more people if we had more infrastructure in place, but we were just, going by the seat of our pants doing what we could. And so we were able to get 13 women out in time for Mother's Day. And so because of the success of that and what we learned on sort of being thrown in the fire, we decided to try to open up this bail fund and to make the community, Philadelphia Community Bail Fund, so that we can bail out all people. And so that has been going strong since November 2017. And our goal is we want to bring our people home. And our ultimate goal, of course, is decarceration, and we want to end money bail. And in the meantime, we're trying to raise money and do all we can to bring as many people home as possible. Some of the people that we bailed out on Mother's Day alone, one person, Joanne, she was in prison for 5 days. But another woman that we bailed out, she was there for 14 months and had never seen or talked to her attorney. She couldn't even understand her charges. And so for us, we're really convicted having been in the process and speaking with people who are waiting and hoping to get out of jail, that this is a really urgent matter. This is not just a matter of statistics or percentages or we got it down to 24%. It's no, we need to do as much as we can to get our people out.
Thank you, Carl. I'm 28 years old. I'm a single mother who lives in a metro section of Philadelphia. I was arrested last year in May. I was involved in breaking up a fight amongst children in my neighborhood, and I was mistaken for one of the children, and charges was pressed against me. And next thing you know, I was sitting in a small room in front of a TV screen with the judge yelling, $25,000 bail for something I was trying to prevent or even stop the violence. Two weeks prior to the day, I was sitting on the beach with my son, maybe a roller coaster ride in Orlando, Florida. We also got to meet, some of the Disney characters. And just to think something like that, and then you hear lights out, ladies, it's time for him. Only bring tears to your eyes. My son is all I have since losing my stepmother and vice versa back in 2016. When I was in RCF for 5 years, is what I say, but it was 5 days actually. Because 5 days, it felt like 5 years, really. Well, when I was there, the thought of losing my job, losing my house, losing my benefits that helped me support my son, him losing his medical, also thinking who would be there for my son, who would be my son's caretaker, definitely went through my head, and being powerless over a situation is a great feeling. When I got hold of the people who I was involved with, the Philadelphia Community Bail Fund, it was like Christmas, but no, it really was like Christmas. I was told my bail was going to be paid because I was a Black mother and it was Mother's Day weekend. But through out the all the stress, I forgot that it was even Mother's Day weekend. I like cried. I remember when one of the people from the Philadelphia Community Bail Fund came to visit me, and her name was LT came to visit me. And I assumed that she was a lawyer because my mom told me that a lawyer was coming to see me. And when she came, she was like, no, I want to pay your bill. I'm like, more tears just came on my eyes. And it was like, what would I have done without them? Because without them, I would have sat there from May until August, and I definitely would have lost my job. And I'm a single parent, and I'm a lunch lady. I only make $10 if they in overtime during the holiday, if they, so I wasn't able to make a bill of $25,000. So, sorry. The next day after I met Lauren, my bill was paid. I remember trying to use the phone in RCF is like the worst thing in the world. So I was just like next up on this lady to use the phone, and she was like, you all home, and he called my name. I wasn't like even able to use the phone. And when it all happened, like when we came out, I can remember, like all I remember was knocking this lady down with flowers in her hand. And now I remember that lady's